If you make records very quickly, I suppose you could go into a studio a bit wasted or a bit hungover or whatever. The way that we recorded albums, the two don't go. And that's probably one problem that Pete Willis was finding harder and harder to come to terms with, is that the discipline of having to play guitars in such a way and trying to combine that with drinking, you just can't do it. It's very, very hard.
And we must have warned him 100 times. You do that one more time and you're out.
The band were all struggling with the pressure and the slow pace. Their first album was completed in 30 days. Their second, 12 weeks, which they thought was an eternity. Now they were 5 months into Pyromania and had yet to complete a single song.
Months just fly by and we've recorded a chorus and it's like, Jesus, it sounds fantastic, but we haven't done anything else.
By the middle of 1982, 6 months after entering the studio, Def Leppard and producer Mutt Lange had yet to commit a single song to tape.
You never had the sense there was a record being made, a whole record, because you only got pieces of it as you went and did it.
Outside the studio walls, rock and roll was nearing an all-time low. Pop had hijacked the airwaves, and listeners were subjected to the likes of Air Supply, Survivor, and others who churned out novelty records which seemed to be appearing more regularly in the charts. Abracadabra had even charmed their way to number one, but the rock and roll purists weren't buying it.
I'm not sure the record industry knew exactly what kind of music they were making.
There really didn't seem to be a lot happening at that time that really touched the heart.
American radio was locked tightly into the bloated 70s, playing the likes of Boston, Skinner, and the Allmans. Bands like Def Leppard were forced to find airplay elsewhere.
For radio, it's tough because then you find yourself kind of afraid to lean too far to metal and experience it. You don't want to offend your audience.
Welcome to MTV Music Television.
But all that changed when upstart MTV stumbled upon the video for Bringing On the Heartbreak from Leppard's second album, High and Dry. Starving for content with 24 hours a day to fill, the channel put Leppard into heavy rotation.
And all of a sudden, all these kids said, oh, Def Leppard, I like that song. And they started buying it. High and dry sales were fueling the record company's coffers, which were in turn paying for the studio costs.
But deep in the bowels of an English studio, the band was oblivious to their growing American fan base. Their concern was on finding some way of meeting producer Mutt Lange's lofty expectations, and they were beginning to wonder if their new album would ever materialize.
Halfway through trying to record the bass guitar for Photograph, thinking, you know, I really don't want to do this. It's just too much stress, it's too much hassle.
Mutt's militant work ethos exacted a heavy toll on the Leppard's psyche.
I mean, I remember times where I just broke down and just bawled my eyes out thinking, I can't sing, because it was 9 months into the album and I was physically exhausted.
Mutt has a certain way you have to sing, and he put Joe Elliott through his paces.
Lange's hypersensitive ears could detect even the subtlest vocal imperfection. Singer Joe Elliott rarely stepped away from the mic, recording songs word by word, hour after hour.
I lost my voice really badly at one stage. And I also lost my confidence, big time. I actually really thought, I'm never going to get through this.
Following a particularly bad day in the recording booth, a disillusioned Joe Elliott wandered into the studio next door. There he found the famously pitch-perfect David Coverdale, recording vocals for a forthcoming Whitesnake album.
Been struggling and struggling and struggling, and he goes out there and sings it in one take. You know, he's out there for like 5 minutes, just dropping in, tidying up a few little bits, and he brings out this bottle of Courvoisier, And I'm just pouring me out, actually, going, God, I wish I could sing like you, man. And he pours me out a brandy, and then he pours me out another brandy. And eventually, I got so drunk, I absolutely just collapsed. I just got really depressed. It was one of them things I shouldn't have seen. David Coverdale doing a vocal in 4 minutes.
Drummer Rick Allen was busy living his own personal hell after long since being replaced by a drum machine. After sitting on the sideline for months, Mutt finally called him in.
I did one take of a certain section of the song, and he'd say, just listening, Rick. I'd be waiting there. Just listening. Listening again. We'll be with you in a little while. Just listening, Rick. I'm like, you guys, I mean, why don't you let me listen to it? And I'll tell you. And it was like, when I want your opinion, Rick, I'll ask you for it. And I just lost it. I was like, whoa. I just started launching drumsticks at the control room.
In fact, he buried one stick in the wall.
It's just frustration, because all he's doing is hitting cymbals, and Mutt will be in the control room saying, no. And the only reason it's not right is because he's slightly out of time.
I just think he knew what he wanted, and really, he knew how to get it. And the fact that I was having a breakdown was really my problem.
To prevent a complete band meltdown, Langer broke up the marathon sessions with moments of levity. One such moment was destined for Leppard Law. For years, fans have debated what exactly is being said in the intro to Rock of Ages, and who said it.
The intro to Rock of Ages is Mutt Lang. He made all these stupid things up. Instead of going one, two, three, four, he started saying all these ridiculous things just to make everybody laugh. You know, I remember one of them was chapati, papadum, something, something. It's all about Indian food. And the other one was Unter Glieben, Glausen, Globen, or whatever it is.
Occasional comic moments offered brief respite, but soon enough it was back to work. Mutt leaned hard on the Leppards. In turn, guitarists Pete Willis and Steve Clark leaned harder on rock's oldest crutch.
Steve was probably drinking more, if not the same as I was, but he was a different type of guy. He wouldn't say boo to a ghost, basically.
Everyone's a when they're drunk. It's just what level of you are. And, you know, Pete Willis drunk was a grade A.
Pete couldn't drink. Well, he could, actually. He did it quite a lot. But the problem is his body couldn't handle it. He was only 5 foot two, and he used to drink the same amount as a fully grown gorilla would.
The band had been warning Pete to clean up his act for years, but he never did.
On the road, we let it go, but as soon as he started doing it in the studio, that was it.
In July 1982, guitarist Steve Clark headed home to dry out for 2 weeks. Pete Willis was left to do double guitar duty, and the added workload was too much to bear. Following an ugly night at the pub, Pete staggered into the studio to record a solo for the song Stage Fright.
Obviously, I tried to, you know, play the guitar, and that wasn't happening at all. And that's when Mutt exploded at me. So, because of that, I turned around and I, you know, gave Mutt a mouthful back, and it just went downhill from there, really. If Mutt's listening, I'm sorry for giving you a mouthful.
Mutt ordered Pete back to Sheffield to sober up. Then he played a recording for Joe Elliott.
He says, come and listen to this. And he played this solo that Pete tried to play, and Mutt was just sat in his chair crying with laughter at how bad it was.
But for the band, it was no laughing matter. It was clear Pete Willis had to go.
It's very easy to go, you know what, we'll give you another chance. We'd done that so many times that we were starting to make ourselves look silly by just continually giving a last chance.
I was scared that Mutt would just quit on us and say, get somebody else to do it. I'm not working with these losers. Because we weren't losers, one of us was.
It was Pete Willis who first brought Joe Elliott into Def Leppard. But the singer would not let blind loyalty derail the band's last chance at success.
Peter had been passed out on his bed, so I just grabbed everybody and said, look, simple as this, he's out. He came in and he said, look, you know, I'll change my ways, what have you. And it's like, Pete, when, how many more times are we going to hear this? And I forget it.
Once something's been decided like that between a group of friends, it can't be the same again, really. Just for my health and maybe sanity, you know, it's probably the best thing that could have happened to me, which is a hard thing to say.
Pete's vacant seat never got cold. Joe made a call, and within hours, Pete's position was filled. Londoner Phil Collin perfected in no time what a drunken Willis couldn't.
He said, oh, you want to come down and play some solos? We've got all the songs on the record, you just got to play a few solos.
So I thought, what a great way of auditioning the guy. Said, Phil, this is a song, listen to it for an hour or so, we need a guitar solo. So he came in after about half an hour, played this amazing one-take guitar solo.
Collin's six-string prowess pleased even the scrupulous producer.
Look, comes out of the control room, big beaming grin on his face. This guy is good. This is the guy. This is just nailed the quickest solo I've ever recorded for this band. And that's the solo that's on the record.
Phil's arrival re-energised the sagging sessions, and not a moment too soon. Def Leppard had spent hundreds of thousands of pounds, and the record company was getting anxious.
Record companies don't like to spend that kind of money if they can avoid it. You know, it's, unless there's an obvious payoff. Fleetwood Mac gets to do that because they've got a track record. The Leppards had no track record.
And manager Peter Mensch was running out of excuses.
Every couple of months, they go, so where's the record? I go, well, you know, it's coming along. Don't worry about it. Yeah, I was scared.
Def Leppard had hoped their third album, Pyromania, would stir rock from a deep sleep. Instead, it was proving a nightmare for their record company. Nearly 1 year into the recording process, Pyromania was well overdue and well over budget. Polygram needed a product, not just promises.
I remember everyone saying, what the hell has taken so long? And it was like, give me that record.
To buy time and keep the funds coming, manager Peter Mensch teased label bosses with snippets of unfinished tracks.
He came up and said, I want to go out and play you something, and played me Photograph and Rock of Ages. And I literally tried to bribe the music out of his hands. And he said, no, we're not finished, but just a little taste.
In December 1982, after 11 grueling months in the studio, producer Mutt Lange and Def Leppard emerged with 10 tracks, 45 minutes of sonic history.
A zillion voices, guitars, you know, piled one on top of the other, you know, drums that sounded like, you know, literally Hammer of the Gods.
The record was the first of its kind, but invention alone doesn't pay. Def Leppard was a million plus in the red. And if that wasn't enough, the band's high hopes were overshadowed by self-doubt.
We thought we had something that was cool and different, but that doesn't really mean much a lot of the time.
We are either completely missing the boat, barking up the wrong tree, whatever you want to call it, or we have got an album which could potentially just sell millions.
Pyromania was released on the 20th of January 1983 to a frosty critical reception. In America, the band was dismissed as a B-rated AC/DC. In the UK, rock critics declared their polished approach a metal travesty.
Too polished. What is too polished? If we weren't happy with it, we wouldn't have put it out.
There are two types of critics. There's a critic that will look at it for what it is and go behind the thought process of what you're trying to do. And there's a critic that will sit there and go, it is not this, it's not what music is about. Those type of people slated the album because it was exactly what they hated in music.